Robert Durst, Mr. Durst is present, and Mr. Chesnov and Mr. DeGuerin, Mr. Balian, and Mr. Milius are at council table, and Mr. Lewin, Mr. Miata, and Mr. Henderson are present. All of our jurors and alternates have taken their places. The witness, Mella Kaufman, has resumed the witness stand, and I'll remind you that you are under oath.
Okay.
Mr. Chesnov, you may resume your cross-examination of the witness.
Thank you, Your Honor. Ms. Kaufman, again, appreciating you being here and how difficult this is. I took the lunch hour and narrowed it so that we can finish.
Thank you.
You're welcome. When you have this memory of Susan telling you a story when you're near UCLA, you didn't mention in that story that Susan told you she talked to the dean of the medical school and told the dean of the medical school that she didn't want to make up her rotation or classes. No detail like that, correct?
Correct.
Okay. Do you remember making a statement that Mr. Durst was just one of the many people who could have pissed Susan off?
Sure.
So Susan had the ability to make a lot of enemies, correct?
Yes.
And you had actually known that other people were angry at Susan at times, correct?
Objection, relevant, Your Honor, court's prior rulings on third-party culpability.
Yeah, I won't take it for that purpose, but I'll overrule the objection.
Okay, I'll move along here, Your Honor. But you're clear that when whatever you were told by Susan by UCLA in this story that she was telling you, she made no mention of any details of any conversation with a dean at the law, at the medical school, did she?
No, she most definitely did say something like that. I thought the question was, did I say that in something?
So have you ever said that before?
I don't know if I have. I think I've definitely said something similar to that many times.
But you know in reading or in hearing, watching the Jinx, that that's been something that's been said. But you certainly will acknowledge to the jury.
I didn't watch Jinx.
Okay. Well, you'll certainly acknowledge to the jury that this morning you never said anything like that, correct?
This morning I did not.
And at no time in the four interviews with the police did you ever say anything like that, correct?
Your Honor, that seems a fact, not an evidence, that the witness has the foundation to know exactly what she said in each interview.
I'm sorry. Overruled.
Thank you. Could you please answer?
Sorry, can you repeat the question?
At no time prior to just now have you ever reported to anybody the details of this alleged conversation that Susan Berman says she had with the medical school, correct?
That's incorrect. So I have said something in a vague sense, in more vague terms, that she made a call,
right,
that either helped the school or employment, which may have been related to the school,
okay,
not suspect Kathleen's missing.
Right, but this is when you were 13, right?
Uh-huh.
Yes?
Sorry, what was when I was 13?
This conversation.
Yes.
And you've acknowledged that it's foggy, correct?
Yes.
And you acknowledge that you don't know the details, correct?
I know which details I know.
Right. And you've stated them, right? And every chance that you've had to talk about the death of Susan Berman with law enforcement, at no time did you ever tell anyone any specific detail of the nature of the call, did you?
Nobody specifically asked me any questions such as that up until my conversation with John Lewin.
Right. So let me ask it to you a different way.
Okay.
This is a woman who you loved?
Yes.
Someone who was murdered?
Yes.
You had multiple opportunities to share information about her that could lead to finding out who actually killed her, correct?
I did not take those opportunities as having that purpose for myself.
Okay, but you didn't take the opportunity to share information with the authorities or with people interested in finding out who actually killed Susan Berman?
I think I can clarify by saying...
Can you just please try to answer that? You didn't do that, did you?
I need you to restate. Sorry.
And I would just ask that the witness be able to finish her answer before
I don't think she was finished with her answer. I'm just... But everybody's talking except the person who's answering the question. So let's stop for a moment. You were answering. You're starting to answer the question, and you were not. Please finish your answer.
Thank you. On none of those occasions with those interviews did I feel what I probably should have, which was an attempt to help them figure out who had murdered Susan.
Okay.
I would say that, in fact, I had a resistance to that out of childish resentment at all the insane ways it had been handled and ways that I had felt hurt. And additionally, as I mentioned earlier, I was not in a place to really be thoughtful or present about what I was feeling or what I was even saying. So additionally, nobody ever directly asked me those questions. When they did, I was able to recall as much as I can recall, and those things I have said today.
Okay. First, you'd agree that that's your explanation for never telling anybody those facts in 15 years from the date of her death, correct? That's your explanation.
15 years being the Jinx interview or the second?
The first time you ever told anybody was, what you just told us, was Mr. Lewin in 2016.
Correct. That's as far as I can remember, yes.
That's your explanation.
Why I never said it? My other explanation...
No, please just answer that.
That is not my only explanation.
No, okay.
Well, that was the question, wasn't it?
No, the question was, did you just give that as an explanation?
Okay. Yes, that was an explanation.
Okay. And the explanation is that in spite of the fact that this was a murder investigation of someone you loved, you never said anything to anybody until you spoke to Mr. Lewin on the telephone, correct?
I assume the police knew, as I believe they did from the documentary, okay,
please,
when they interviewed me
Your
then.
Honor,
and
would
then
you...
the answer is yes, not until I spoke to John Lewin.
Okay. And it came as a result of questions he was asking you about that subject, correct? You didn't just spontaneously tell him.
Probably, I can't recall.
Well, you said that it was Mr. Lewin who cued you.
He definitely didn't cue me, but it came up in that conversation.
Okay. Court's indulgence. Do you remember in that conversation being asked? I'm going to find out who it was that asked you. I believe it was Mr. Balian. And did she ever discuss with you anything Bob Durst had ever told her about whether he did or didn't kill Kathy? Remember that question?
What page?
I'm sorry. 144021.
That sounds very likely.
And
I don't remember it specifically.
And your answer at the time was no, correct?
I don't know. Will you read it again? Sorry.
Sure. And did she ever discuss with you anything Bob Durst had ever told her about whether he did or didn't kill Kathy? And your answer was no. Is that correct?
Correct.
That's still your answer.
Correct. Yes.
Do you remember being asked by Detective Romero the following? But the alibi part of it is what Susan is saying that other people are saying, that she provided an alibi for him. Or she said, I provided. You know what I mean? You know the difference? Sorry, Mr. Habib, that's 137751. And you wrote, you answered, I know. And he said, I know. And you said, I know the difference. And I, unfortunately, I just don't have a great, like, exact memory about it. Do you remember saying that?
That sounds very likely.
And that was closer in time to when you were 13 years old than it is now, correct?
Yeah. I also was extremely sick at the time from a near-death experience with my last child. And I was very clear with Mr. Lewin that I was not really up to being clear in general.
Well, which... that one was with Detective Romero.
Oh, okay.
Who came to see you.
Okay.
In person.
Okay.
In your house.
Okay.
They were very gracious, weren't they?
I gotcha. They asked me something, and I said, yes, I know the difference. Okay. Okay.
And then you said, it's just, you know, I really, the feeling of it was that she would tell me the story to intrigue me. Correct?
Correct.
So that was another thing that was par for the course with Susan, to tell you little stories, whether they were true or not, to intrigue you. Correct?
I don't feel like Susan was making up lots of stories. She was not honest. She may have exaggerated or made a story more interesting in her delivery. But it was not necessarily like she was making up stories whole cloth and claiming they were real. Okay. That wasn't my experience.
Well, you told us this morning that she was a liar and that she often told people things to either draw them in or to get something she wanted, correct?
Yeah. Again, she wasn't really like that with me. I knew all the lies she was telling, and that was very odd for me to be in that situation, to know the truth and stand by her side as she lied to the external world. That wasn't quite our relationship.
Okay, well, when you're 13 years old and you have this mother figure, it's pretty hard, wouldn't you agree, for a 13-year-old child to know whether that person is telling the truth or not telling the truth. I mean, you hadn't reached the level of education or maturity that you have now at the age of 13.
I had some pretty good skills of discernment naturally through life experience. It did not feel like a lie, nor did that seem like in a pattern of lies.
Okay, but
the story was real.
Okay, but it was foggy, correct?
Yes.
You don't remember the details, correct?
Some of the details I can't say with 100% certainty.
And you never told anybody about it until Mr. Lewin began to ask you questions, correct?
It wasn't a secret. It was out. It was way out in the open already at that point.
Right, in the public.
Yeah.
Okay, so now you're hearing stories in the public consistent with the story or the testimony you're giving us today, correct?
The only public information I heard was way back around the Morris Black murder of his neighbor. Spurred some memory.
Let me stop you.
Yeah.
You just told us it was out in the public, didn't you?
Yes, Jinx had already come out.
Okay. And as a result, you heard a story consistent with the storytelling that Susan had always done with you, correct?
I heard a story consistent with the storytelling.
Well, you told us she always liked to tell you stories,
right?
Yes,
she told me lots of stories, and that was one that was consistent in the style of her stories, yes.
Okay. No further questions.
Redirect examination, Mr. Baileyan.
Thank you, Your Honor. Kaufman, on cross-examination, you were being questioned about whether Susan had helped Sarah because she was a good parent and she got him a lawyer, et cetera. Do you remember that line of questioning?
Yes.
And I think in response you said, well, there was other anecdotes, but you didn't get to say. Is that right?
Yes.
Okay. So were you aware, based on being there, of things that happened, or anecdotes, as you would call them, that you'd like to say, where Susan did things to jump in and help a friend, and they were things that you deemed, oh, that's not something that should be done, or that's not right, or that's unlawful?
In reflection, I can see it as not right. I don't know that I would have experienced it as not right at the time, but yes. A specific one where someone had done something wrong. You know, does it need to be specific, or can I speak a little bit to the general of what those...
Yeah, if it would help be responsive to the question.
Yeah.
Your Honor, I would object.
Grounds, Your Honor?
No, that's my job to ask the grounds for objection, if I need them, if they're not obvious. Yes, they're not obvious here. Go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'm telling you, between Habib and John, no, I don't know what to do.
What have I done?
You objected once. My objection, Your Honor, would be there's lack of foundation.
Overrule.
General ideas would be a girlfriend, maybe King Langford, who felt hurt or slighted in some sort of acting job or situation. And Susan would make phone calls to reprimand, embarrass, etc. Okay. Someone she worked with.
So, Mr. Chesnoff asked you a whole lot of questions on cross-examination before lunch and after lunch. In the area of what you did or didn't tell either Mark and Andrew or law enforcement throughout the years. You're aware of that line of questioning?
Yes.
And in particular, I'm asking about the line of questioning that suggested that it wasn't until you met Mr. Lewin in 2016 that you related this version of events of what Susan had told you that one day. You're aware of the line of questioning?
Yes.
So Mr. Chesnoff indicated that you were questioned in 2001.
Uh-huh.
Is that right?
Yes.
And you were again questioned in 2013 by Mark and Andrew, right?
Just Mark.
By Mark Smirling, I'm sorry. And again in 2015 by Detective Romero, right?
Yes.
And then in 2016 by Mr. Lewin, right?
Correct.
And the import of the questions was that the first revelation of this story came when you spoke to Mr. Lewin.
Right.
You're
that
aware
is
what
the implication.
Okay.
Your Honor, most respectfully, that was the testimony.
Okay.
Thank you.
That was the testimony that you gave, right?
Ah, testimony.
Okay. So I want to take this step by step. In 2001, when the police came and spoke to you, and your mother had just been killed, did you connect the dots that this killing was done by Bobby Durst?
I was not thinking in those terms at all. I wasn't thinking about anyone having done it. I was trying not to think about who may have done it.
Did the police, the detectives in 2001, ask you any questions whatsoever about Bobby Durst?
I don't believe so.
Did they ask you any questions whatsoever that suggested to you that they even thought in 2001, when this had just happened, that Bobby Durst was a suspect?
I don't believe so.
Okay. Was Bobby Durst even on your mind when you spoke to the police in 2001?
No.
Was this story you had when you were a 13 or 14-year-old young lady even on your mind when you spoke to the police in 2001?
No.
Okay. So now we'll go to the next time you were spoken with, and that's in 2013, when you spoke with Mark and Andrew. I'm sorry, Mark Smirling and Andrew Dreck. Do you even remember what you did or didn't speak to them about exactly during that interview?
Not at all.
Do you remember, as you sit here today, I know you've testified, because that's the questions that were asked of you, that you didn't tell this version of events of what happened. Do you even remember if you did or didn't talk about it?
I don't remember, and part of me thinks that we did touch on something, but I couldn't say that with 100% certainty.
Would it refresh your recollection to look at a transcript of that interview?
Sure.
May I approach?
You may.
What page, please?
14.
I'll read page 14.
Okay.
Is that your fresher recollection?
Yes. Yes.
So then in 2013, when you spoke with Mark Smirling, did you or did you not tell them that Susan had told you this version of events about his wife's disappearance and, you know, her being a false alibi?
I did, and in fact, I can also say that from the moment of contact with them, I was clear about the danger and threat with the assumption that Bobby Durst had done it already.
So did you mention there was a story out there that Susan had told you about being a false alibi for Bobby?
Yes.
Okay. Let's go to your interview with Detective Romero when he came out and spoke with you. Now, this is in 2015.
Mm-hmm.
Contrary to whatever you were asked on cross-examination about what you did or did not say, do you remember exactly what you told Detective Romero on this topic back then?
Not at all.
Would it refresh your recollection to look at a police report from that interview?
Page
sure,
three.
Yes.
Page two.
Page what?
0357487 4 8 or 5 7 4 8. Is that first paragraph to yourself?
Is that the report or the transcript?
Report.
Oh, okay. Thank you.
Yeah.
Does that refresh your recollection?
Yes.
So did you in fact discuss with Detective Romero that you had this conversation with Susan?
Yes, I did.
And did you tell Detective Romero that Susan had told you a story about being an alibi for Bob during his wife's disappearance?
Yes.
And did you tell Detective Romero that Susan pretended to be his wife or something like that?
Yes.
And did you tell Detective Romero that Bob's wife was missing and Susan stepped in to help him out and Susan was an alibi for him?
Yes.
So, does this kind of refresh your memory now, seeing all this stuff, that actually you have told these events to law enforcement throughout the years?
Yes.
Was it to John Lewin the first time you ever mentioned this?
No, I'm sorry, yeah.
And was it John Lewin who asked you perhaps more detailed questions about this than ever before?
Probably.
Okay, and did you tell Mr. Lewin and myself and the detectives that were present that Susan told you this story?
Yes.
And did you tell us that she told you that it was about Bobby and his missing wife?
Yes.
And did you tell us that what she told you was that she was an alibi back at the time that his wife went missing for him?
Yes.
And did you tell us that, to the best of your memory, although it was a little foggy, that she did something, made a call on his behalf?
Yes.
And did Mr. Lewin ask you on his scales that he loves from 0 to 100 of how certain your memory are of these events?
I don't remember.
Okay. Well, what do you think you would have said?
Probably 100%.
And are you 100% today on these?
Yes.
Thank you. I have nothing for
additional cross-examination.
Thank you, Your Honor.
The questions that I asked you or whether when you met with Detective Romero or met with Mr. Smirling, did you ever describe to them driving by UCLA and saying that Susan Berman had made a call to the law school? Did you ever tell that to those?
School.
What did I say, high school?
Law school.
Law school. OK. can't help my, it's knee jerk, Your Honor.
Try again.
Sorry. When you spoke to the detective, or you spoke to Mark Smerling, you never told them anything about Susan Berman making a call to the medical school on Bob's behalf, did you?
I know I just refreshed my memory. I don't know if there was a lack of a statement of a call or not.
Okay, but today, when you testified, Mr. Bailian brought out on your testimony that you had a memory of a drive by UCLA where Susan Berman told you she called the law school.
Medical school, gosh.
I believe the detail of driving on Sunset by UCLA may have come up in the conversation with Mr. Lewin first.
Okay.
For the first time.
But also for the first time was this discussion that Susan Berman had called the medical school, which is an important issue in this case. You never told that to anybody until you spoke to Mr. Lewin, did you?
Some of the memories came back as we discussed it in more detail, and my focus was on it for the first time.
But you never told it to Smerling, did you?
No.
And you never told it to...
Possibly.
Well, you just had a chance to read it.
Right, but I feel like I just went down this rabbit hole where I could believe you that I didn't say it, and I just don't know if that's true.
Okay, I appreciate that you do, because I wouldn't mislead you. You never told Smerling, you never told Romero anything about Susan Berman imparting to you that she had called the medical school, correct?
I can't say with any certainty.
Well, you just read the statements.
Okay.
Was it in there?
Objection vague, which part?
I mean, I,
you wouldn't quarrel with me if I told you that when you spoke to Smerling,
I didn't mention specifically the call was being to the medical school?
Correct.
That's probably true.
And when you spoke to the detectives who'd come all the way to Portland, Oregon to interview about the death of your loved one, if I told you you didn't say it then, would you agree with me?
Sure.
Nothing further.
Redirect?
No, thank you, Your Honor.
Okay. May the witness be excused?
Yes, thank you.
Thank you,
Your Honor. Excuse. The people may call their next witness.
It's like your tag team now, Your Honor. DeGuerin's going to slap me, and your belly is going to slap
you. Okay. Shall I quietly recall and quash the body attachment? I do.
I'm sorry, I couldn't hear.
I won't say it too long. We'll wait till later.
Oh, okay.
You'll do it. We'll put on the record later.
Sorry, Your Honor.
Body attachment.
You're getting the witness, Your Honor.
Right. You sure?
I'm good. I had nothing to do with it.
Okay.
Okay, you got it.
I like the new mask.
What's that, Your Honor?
I like the new mask.
That's called brown.
Okay.
before.
Sure.
Okay. I think the court would agree. These are much cooler. You don't end up, they don't stick to your nose. This is the way to go if you have to wear masks.
How'd you find my haberdasher? That's what I want to know. I'm going to
stick away. Be right back.
What do you mean?
I read about a barbecue place nearby. Have you found it yet? About two blocks away on that side of La Brea. I haven't been there myself. Just trying to make sure you have lunch options.
You want us napping out here? Your Honor, one of the elevators is flashing between 6 and 5. That does not look good.
Do you think somebody jammed it?
So they might be in that elevator.
I have an alibi.
Which is who's with great, great. Have you texted? The elevator has no reception.
Okay. Listen to a video.
Mr. Chesnoff and Mr. Durst and I all have alibis.
23 witnesses.
We could have been
witness is present.
Please stand in the witness stand. Remain standing, raise your right hand to be sworn. Do you solemnly state that the testimony you may give in the cause now pending before this court shall be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes, I do.
Leave it on, please. But as a result, you'll need to talk right into that microphone so we can hear your answers.
Mm-hmm. Please state and spell your first and last name. Please state and spell your first and last name, sir.
Douglas Oliver.
And spell it.
Oh, sir. D-O-U-G-L-I-S-O-L-I-V-E-R.
Thank you, sir.
You know, I'm going to guess, I don't think the jurors could probably hear him. It was hard for me to hear him.
No, he was speaking only to our to our judicial assistant, so I just mentioned to him, and that illustrates that you'll need to talk right into that microphone. You can pull it close to you. You can adjust the microphone so that we can hear your answers.
Certainly.
Right.
And
Mr. Oliver,
speak up as well.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Oliver, do you recognize this man right here?
Yes.
Pointing to the defendant. Who do you know him to be?
Robert Durst.
And how do you know Mr. Durst?
I know him from New York City.
And when did the two of you first meet?
1977.
And can you explain the circumstances of how you came to be acquainted with Mr. Durst?
I called the Durst Organization, and I asked for a meeting with someone who was be involved in a property on Broadway, and I was put through to Seymour Durst, who suggested I come in and meet with him.
And at that time, Mr. Oliver, is it fair to say that you had some real estate interests, but not to the same level as the Dursts?
Best of my recollection, yes.
And at that time, your father-in-law was a man named Abe Hirschfeld, is that correct?
Yes.
And your father-in-law was a very well-known real estate mogul, businessman, producer in New York City, is that correct?
No.
Okay, can you tell me who Abe Hirschfeld was?
He's my father-in-law.
Can you tell me what kind of work Mr. Hirschfeld did?
He was a real estate owner in New York City.
And did he own like just one little house, or did he own a lot of real estate?
I really haven't can't recollect how much real estate he owned.
Can you recollect that Mr. Hirschfeld was extremely wealthy?
I have no idea what his net worth was, sir.
Okay, so you were married to his daughter, is that correct?
Correct.
And how long were you and his daughter married for?
Less than 7 years.
And you had a child yourself together, is that correct? You and your ex-wife?
Yes.
So during the time that you knew Mr. Hirschfeld, did you become involved yourself in real estate?
I was involved in real estate before I met Mr. Hirschfeld.
Do you recall previously stating, Mr. Oliver, that you married your ex-wife, Rachel, in 1973?
I don't recall me making that statement.
Okay, this is going to be pleasant. When did you marry your wife, Rachel?
In 1973.
And in 1975, did you believe that you had made enough money and you didn't have to work again?
No.
Do you recall saying to me during a recorded interview on October 30th, 2019, that in 1975 you thought you had made enough money and did not have to work again, and you moved to Paris, but you ran out of money and came back to New York? Do you recall saying that?
No, I do not.
Is that true or false?
Is it what, true or false?
Is the statement, Mr. Oliver, I was going to wait a little while, Your Honor, but really, so, Your Honor, at this point in time, pursuant to the motion that the people previously filed under Evidence Code Section 767, as well as the Williams case at 43 Cal 4th, 584 at 631, the Spain case, SPAIN 1984 at 154 Cal App 3rd at 853, citing Goldenson, an 1888 case. You don't get to do that every day.
Oh, Goldenson.
Mr. Guerin might have argued that case. I'm not sure. Your Honor, I'm going to ask that the witness be designated as an adverse witness.
So, yes, granted.
Thank you, Your Honor. Okay. Mr. Oliver, are you denying that you stated during the interview on October 30th, 2019, that by 1975, you thought you'd made enough money, you didn't have to work again, so you moved to Paris, but ran out of money and moved back to New York?
I'm not denying it. I just don't recall ever saying that.
So, well, what I asked you is that a true statement, yes or no?
A true statement. You mean why I moved to Paris?
Okay, so, again, I'm going to take this in parts.
I'm having trouble understanding.
Okay, I'll take it in parts. In 1975, did you believe that you had made enough money and you didn't have to work again?
No.
Did you previously state that?
I don't recall stating that.
So if you had stated it, it would be incorrect then, is that what you're saying?
Incorrect that I didn't understand it? I'm a little confused what you're trying to
okay.
get at, sir.
Well, so Mr. Haller, if you can, instead of worrying about what you think I'm trying to do, if you could just answer my questions, it'll go a lot faster.
I am, sir.
Decide more and more. Object to that remark.
No. Overruled. But I will suggest that that each question be minute. In other words, just identify one fact and present that fact, since you're leading.
That's what I will do, Your Honor.
Okay? For affirmation or not.
At one point in time, you moved to Paris, is that correct?
Yes.
And while in Paris, you ran out of money, is that correct?
No.
Did you previously state that you ran out of money while you were in Paris?
I do not recall stating that.
I'm sorry?
I do not recall
relevance.
That.
Objection, relevance.
Overruled. It's foundational material about this witness.
About running out of money in Paris?
I'm not going to call upon Mr. Lewin now to describe the scenario under which this will become relevant. I'm going to give him some leeway. Otherwise, Mr. Lewin will be stating his case so that he should be eliciting from the witness. So I am going to give him leeway. You may proceed.
Would you agree, Mr. Oliver, that Robert Durst is somebody you care very much about?
Yes.
Do you consider yourself in the courtroom today to be a neutral, unbiased witness?
Yes.
Are you here just to answer our questions and to tell us what you know?
That's what I'm supposed to do, correct?
Again, if you can answer my question.
Yeah, I'm here to answer the questions, yes, of course.
Is it fair to say, Mr. Oliver, that you did not want to come to court?
No.
That's not a fair thing to say.
No.
Is it fair to say that you have been uncooperative with nearly every attempt to contact you since Mr. Durst was arrested in 2015?
I'm here. I'm very cooperative.
So listen to my question. Have you been cooperative throughout the investigation since 2015?
I believe so.
Okay. You have an attorney, is that correct, Mr. Oliver?
Yes.
And you were ordered, in fact, you were ordered by Judge Windham to be in court and have been on call, having no choice to come or not to come to court. Is that correct?
I'm in court, sir.
So, Mr. Oliver, if you can, I want you to listen to my question very carefully. You were ordered by Judge Windham to be on call to me in my office. Is that correct?
To the best of my recollection, yes.
And in fact, you got a lawyer, is that correct, who has been dealing with us regarding figuring out the time for you to come to court. Is that correct?
Correct.
Now, with respect to getting that lawyer, you or your lawyer requested the transcripts of your prior interviews. Is that correct?
I'm not sure if she did.
Well, let me ask us, do you have in your possession or have you listened to the prior interviews that you've given in this case that were recorded?
I've seen some transcripts of some of the conversations, yes.
If you can, and again, maybe it's my bad hearing, but Your Honor, could the court inquire of the jury if they can hear him? I can't very well.
Okay, please raise your voice.
Is this better?
Yes.
Okay, sorry.
Okay, so I want to go back to 1982. Were you contacted or interviewed at all by New York Police Department investigators in 1982 at the time that Kathy Durst disappeared?
In 1982?
Yes.
I believe so, yes.
You believe you were interviewed at that time?
Yes, you've told me several times.
Have you... Do you know who interviewed you?
No.
Have you ever told us or been provided with an interview of what you allegedly said back in 1982?
I've never seen, you mean like a transcript or?
So what I'm asking you is, and let me say it this way, what makes you believe you were interviewed in 1982? Do you have an actual memory of that?
Actually, I don't have a memory of it.
Okay, so you don't know whether you were interviewed in 1982 or not?
No, I believe I was interviewed. You've told me I was interviewed.
2001, correct? Mr. Oliver's when you were interviewed first. Is that correct?
You know, at the best of my recollection, I can't remember.
Did you ever yourself reach out to investigators at the time that Kathy Durst disappeared?
I do not believe I ever reached out to anyone.
Any reason why not?
No.
Well, you knew at some point that she was missing, correct?
Correct.
And you and Bob Durst were very close friends back in 1982, is that correct?
Yes.
And did you believe that potentially, Mr. Oliver, strike that, you knew that you had spoken to Mr. Durst the week after his wife allegedly disappeared, correct?
I don't recall that.
So you do remember being contacted by investigators from the New York State Police in 2001, is that right?
Well, first of all, I'm not sure if it was the New York State Police. I'm not sure which police department.
Counsel, will you stipulate, it will save us a little bit of time, that Mr. Oliver was interviewed on December 19, 2001 by New York State Police?
I don't know that.
Yeah.
What's that?
There's no stipulation.
Okay. We'll do it the long way. Do you?
They've not stipulated to that fact, so Mr. Lewin will be inquiring of you. You'll answer questions about that.
Okay. Sure.
Talk loud into that
microphone. I'm sorry.
Do you recall Mr. Oliver being interviewed in Westchester County by investigators who were either from the New York State Police or the Westchester County District Attorney's Office?
I do not recall that.
And in saying that you do not recall it, then I assume you don't have any memory of what you would have said to them. Is that correct?
At the best of my knowledge, I can't remember what I said to them.
Well, you've been asked before by me about this interview in 2001, correct?
I don't recall that.
So you don't remember during our 2019 interview, you being asked about what you had said to investigators in 2001? You have no memory of that?
To the best of my recollection, I cannot remember anything.
Let me see if this helps. Do you recall, Mr. Oliver, saying to detectives in 2001 that you believe that Kathy Durst might have been sold into white slavery because of her cocaine problem? Do you recall saying that?
I do not recall that. Is that a document you're referring to?
Yeah, it's my document.
May I see that?
No. You may not. Do you recall, Mr. Oliver?
Recall what?
Do you recall making that comment that you believed that Kathy Durst had been sold into white slavery because of her cocaine problem?
I do.
What's that?
To my recollection, I cannot recall that.
Do you recall being asked about this during the 2019 interview with me and responding that, quote, Bob Durst didn't tell you that. You were probably, quote, just being funny when you said it. Do you recall saying that?
I do not recall that.
And as you sit here today, are you telling me that the first time you can ever recall the subject of Kathy Durst being sold into white slavery is during this examination today?
I don't remember if I said that or not.
Well, let me ask you, do you think if you would have said it, you would have remembered it?
I don't know how to answer that.
Well, does the concept, Mr. Oliver, of Kathy Durst being sold into white slavery, does that sound like something that you could have thought?
No, I would never have thought of that, I don't believe.
So I want you to assume for a moment in this hypothetical that you made that comment. Can you explain why you would have said that?
Wait a minute, that's assuming something you said you don't remember. Objection, false.
Your
false statement.
Okay, false statement is not a valid objection.
I'm sorry, my mouth got stuck in my mask.
Okay, unstick your mouth and make a valid objection.
It's a hypothetical, not based on a valid basis.
Okay, sustained.
Well, Your Honor,
sustained. Close enough.
Get that, sustained.
Your Honor.
Yes.
As an offer of proof, detectives will be coming in to testify to that statement.
I object to the offer of proof.
If counsel has
this
the discovery,
this is a speaking objection, and I object to it.
Okay, everybody, inhale.
Shall we take a break now?
Exhale. That's okay. Our break will be quite brief. Pause.
I think I need to meditate on this.
You do. All right.
Would you like the bait stamp discovery page where this statement is indicated, Your Honor?
Okay, no, I know. You're so you intend to supply this factual basis.
Foundational to impeachment subject to 1235 of the evidence code of people versus Green.
All right, yeah. Why would you say it? I think, if hypothetically said it, why would you say it? Okay, objection's overruled.
I'm sorry.
I thought you sustained
the objection.
Pardon?
I thought you sustained
I did, but I've rethought it. I'm going to overrule it. Mr. Lewin says he's going to supply the factual basis for it. In other words, it's not assuming a fact that won't be proved. I'll strike it if that fact is not supplied.
I think I know what he's going to supply, and it's bootstrapping. He's supplying his own basis for it.
But, well,
it's their writing. It's not the witness's writing.
We'll see.
You
may proceed.
Thank you, Your Honor. So, listen to my question, Mr. Oliver. I want you to assume, for the purposes of this hypothetical, that you made a statement to New York State investigators on December 19th, 2001, that said that you believed that Kathy might have been sold into white slavery because of her cocaine problem. So I'm now asking you to assume you said that. So my question is, can you explain why you would have said that?
Again, that's assuming that it said it.
Overruled, but I'm gonna strike it unless I'm gonna have you introduce the inconsistent statement.
Okay. Well,
but after you ask the hypothetical about why, and then I'll
Your Honor, that's going to come through. A witness is going to testify. I can give the court all the authority, but that witness is going to be coming out and testifying.
Speaking objection.
Counsel has the discovery, Your Honor. It's not a dispute. It's what was said.
Okay. I'll strike it if it's not supplied, if the factual basis isn't supplied. If counsel has a different way to introduce that fact other than introduction through this witness of his, I mean, you could publish the inconsistent statement now if you wished, but I'll strike it unless you publish it one way or another.
Thank you, Your Honor. Did you understand my question, Mr. Oliver?
Not really.
Okay, so I'm having you assume that you made that statement to detectives. So I'm just trying to understand why you would have said, if you have any idea, why you would have told them that you believe that Kathy Durst might have been sold into white slavery because of a cocaine problem.
I don't believe I ever told them.
So you're denying, so here's what I'm asking. I want you to assume for a moment that you said that. I'm asking you to assume you said it. Would it be your testimony then that you would not be able to explain why you would have said that?
No, I can't.
Wait a minute. Objection. As to a hypothetical question, the witness has disputed.
He denies saying it, so why would you say something and he denies saying it? So it appears nonsensical in a way.
It is.
On the other hand, if the...
That's my objection, yeah. Nonsensical.
Nonsensical.
I don't
right.
think that's not an objection.
No. I understand. The objection is that it's an improper hypothetical, and I've overruled that objection. Okay.
So... Let's continue.
Subject to a motion to strike, for reasons I explained.
Mr. Oliver, you were not contacted by any law enforcement relating to Kathy's disappearance between 2001 and 2015. Is that correct?
To the best of my recollection, I can't recall.
Okay, keep it louder.
I can't recall.
And do you recall, Mr. Oliver, being called on the telephone by what everybody would stipulate in this courtroom is the nice prosecutor, as he's known, Mr. Habib?
Stipulated.
Do you recall Mr. Balian calling you on the phone, Mr. Oliver, on April 29, 2015?
I do not recall that.
And are you saying you don't recall it was Mr. Balian, or you don't recall being contacted by district attorneys from our office?
I don't remember the call.
And I would assume then that you also do not remember what your demeanor was in terms of agreeing to speak with them. Is that correct?
I don't remember that.
Were you cooperative?
I believe I was.
Your Honor, we're going to play clip D001. This is from April 29, 2015, page 3, line 21 to page 4, line 14.
Improper impeachment on a collateral matter.
What?
I don't know if it's collateral or not. Is this the same thing?
Yes. April 29, 2015, first interview.
Relevant.
Overruled.
Your Honor, can we mark this as 95 and 95A?
Yes.
What's the status of your relationship? Are you guys?
I'm not sure if I'm comfortable talking to you. I don't know how this is going to help him or help you. I mean, how did it help anybody?
Well, you know, I'm a prosecutor with Los Angeles County. I'm after just the truth, trying to figure out what the truth is here, and I don't see how speaking to me, you know, would be a problem if everyone is just after the truth. I mean, is there information you have that maybe you don't want to provide, or is it just that you don't have information, that you don't think you have information, or what's your hesitancy to speak with me?
I'm not sure. I'm not sure why I don't want to speak to you.
Yeah.
I really haven't thought about it, to be honest with you.
How good of...
Don't ask me any questions. I've got to determine whether I want to talk to you. Okay, I have to decide.
Do you recognize that voice?
Yes.
That's you, isn't it?
Correct.
Would you call that cooperative, Mr. Oliver?
I think I was being cooperative.
And would you say that Mr. Balian was
Say that louder, please.
Yes.
You would call that cooperative?
Yes.
Would you say that Mr. Balian was being rude or offensive in the way that he was questioning you?
Impeachment on a collateral matter. Overruled. This is not relevant.
Overruled.
If he's free, will the court instruct the jury that he was free to refuse to talk if he wanted to? And he said he didn't know whether he was going to talk.
No, I won't. That's true, what you're saying, but the point that Mr. Lewin is trying to make goes to the credibility of this witness, and so I will not instruct them as you have requested.
And my objection is it doesn't go to the credibility of the witness. He's merely asking if he can decide whether he wants to talk.
Yeah, that's for the jury to decide whether or not it impugns his credibility. You may be seated. Your objection is overruled.
And the final objection is, we finally have a witness who is talking back to Mr. Lewin, and I think that he had a right to do that, Your Honor.
He's not broken a law, has he? But that's all right. That's for the jury to decide. You may go ahead.
Mr. Oliver, do you recall, or even from listening to that clip, was Mr. Balian in any way rude or demeaning to you?
No, he wasn't rude to me.
Do you need to speak louder? You're kind of mumbling.
No.
Would you agree that during that initial conversation with Mr. Balian, that instead of answering questions, you were asking questions on your own, trying to figure out why you were being called?
Could you restate that again, please?
So, do you agree, Mr. Oliver, that during your first contact with the Los Angeles County District Attorney's Office on April 29, 2015, that rather than answering the questions that you were being asked, that you yourself wanted your own questions answered about what the office was doing, who was being interviewed, et cetera, and not answering those of Mr. Balian?
That's compound question, and it's not relevant.
Okay. It is compound. Sustained. Individual questions when you're leading.
During that conversation, Mr. Oliver, did you answer any of Mr. Balian's questions?
Yes.
You did. Did you ask Mr. Balian questions on your own?
According to this, yes.
Well, I'm not asking you to look at a transcript. We're talking about a different clip now. I'm asking you, if you recall, during that first conversation, did you agree to answer Mr. Balian's questions, or did you merely ask questions of him of your own?
The best of my recollection, I don't recall.
Clip number 002, 429, 2015, page 4, line 21 to page 5, line 5.
Your Honor, can we mark this as 96 and 96A as the transcript?
Yes.
Is that an offer to introduce it, Your
Honor? No. Do you object to its
I do.
Is this a, well, I'll review it. You have an inconsistent statement?
Yeah, it's a statement. It's a prior inconsistent statement under Green.
Okay. I need to see it to rule on the objection. So please give me a copy of this.
Your Honor, may I approach? I don't have
Come around
paper.
This way. Go approach with your screen. You don't have this printed?
I don't have it printed up.
Yes, you may come around. Unplug it and come around.
John has a copy of
that. May I approach, Your Honor?
Yes. Buy a whole case. Yes, we will. Thank you.
May I continue, Your Honor?
Supply be witnessed with water.
Thank you very much. Oh, goodness.
You can keep that. Souvenir of Department 1. Thank you. I'm going to let parties give anybody a call.
That was out of.
I'm going to let them, yeah.
And to be clear, my objection is impeachment on a collateral matter and not relevant.
Okay, those are overruled.
May Mr. Milius play the clip now, Your Honor?
Yes.
We're talking to, you know, anyone who we have information that may have information.
Who have you called so far?
Well, you know, unfortunately, I'm in a situation where I can't really share with witnesses, like, the status of an investigation. I can only hope that witnesses will...
Well, I'm not a witness.
Well, no, but individuals who may have information, we're hoping they'll just speak to us and tell us what they do or don't know.
So you talk to some people and they're already witnesses?
Does that refresh your memory?
Regarding what?
I can't.
Say, speak into the mic.
Does that refresh your memory, Mr. Oliver, that rather than answering questions, you were simply asking them?
That
yes.
That was the original question,
huh? Overall.
And relevancy on whether he was asking questions or not.
Overall.
Did you indicate during that interview with Mr. Balian, Mr. Oliver, that you were aware that Mr. Balian was interviewing other people that knew Bob Durst?
This has refreshed my memory, yes.
So it's not on this clip. I'm asking you, just want to be clear, I'm asking you, you're looking down at a clip, which is not what I'm asking you about, so just listen to my question. During that conversation, did you tell Mr. Balian that you were aware that the district attorney's office in Los Angeles was talking to people that knew Bob Durst?
Well, it says that I'm aware of it.
So do you want to answer my question? You know what? I'm just going to play clip number 3. This is page 5, line 17 to page 8, line 10. And by the way, Your Honor, Mr. DeGuerin has.
I know.
He can look up when I give
sure.
the page numbers.
I don't have the clips that he has. I have the transcript, but I don't know what he's going to do.
That's why I'm giving you page numbers, Mr. DeGuerin.
Yeah, okay. So do you understand each other? Like Mr. Lewin is telling the court that you have these. And
actually,
he's
making a speech, Your Honor, what? And I object to that.
Right. I don't know that it really bears on any...
We're here about Susan Berman.
Right, thank you, Mr. DeGuerin. All right. You may proceed.
Okay, clip number 3.
You need to mark it?
Yes, 97 and 97A.
Yeah.
Thank you, Your Honor.
You're talking to people in the new Bob, okay? But you didn't give me names. I'm curious who else is talking to you.
Well, I can't really provide you that information.
You can't means you physically are unable to. You won't, is what you're saying.
Yeah, I will not share with other people the status of a criminal investigation.
It's not a status. You're just answering questions. Come on, what is this?
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not a it's not really a game. You could probably guess who we're talking.
No, you're not playing a game at all. I don't understand what you're playing it at me. I'm not going to talk to someone who's not going to be a forthright and honest with me. And if you can't talk to me, just tell me.
Yeah, I'm being honest with you.
No, you're not.
I'm not. I'm being honest right now. I'm really not allowed to talk to you.
Who said you're not allowed to talk to me about that?
Well, that's just the way it works.
That's the way it works. It's not that you're wrong, okay? Come on. You know, I don't like when you talk down to me like that, okay?
Okay, well, I apologize you're taking it that way.
Well, I am, because, you know, you can tell me who you're talking to. Does it hurt you? So why, when you decide you want to talk to me, this is not going to be a one-way conversation, okay? I don't like one-way conversations, okay?
Yeah. Well,
okay. I mean, I don't know how I can help you. I don't know how I can help you. Give me one reason why I should talk to someone who won't tell me anything.
You know, it's not a matter of helping me. I'm after the truth, so, you know, you might have
information. You're not after the truth. You have to admit I have the truth. You have the truth, but you're not telling me the truth.
I'm telling you the truth. I'm telling you I can't tell you who I'm speaking with in an open investigation. I'm asking you whether you're willing to provide me information that might be helpful to Mr. Durst, information that might show he's guilty, information that might show he's innocent. I'm just trying to get to the truth. Are you willing to do that?
If you're honest with me, yes.
Well, I was just honest with you. I'm not going to tell you who I'm speaking to and what they're saying.
Then there's no reason for us to speak anymore. Okay. This is not a one-way conversation, okay? Well, why should I do this for you? Give me a reason.
Well, a reason is because who I'm assuming is your good friend, who you've known since 1977. Is in jail, and you may have information which is helpful to him. You may have information that's harmful to him, and perhaps you just want to get to the truth. Or assist us.
Then I guess I should talk to his attorneys, not you.
Well, if that's your choice and what you perceive would be the proper way to go, then that's what you'll do. I can't make you talk to me. I'm asking you whether you're willing to talk to me.
No, not after this conversation. I did until you called me.
Yeah. Okay. What information is it that you were hoping I'd be able to give you?
Because I'm not interested in talking to someone and having a one-way conversation. It's a give-and-take world, okay?
Mr. Oliver, would you characterize your attitude on that call as cooperative?
Attitude? What relevance? Attitude?
Oh, rule. Credibility. You may answer.
Would you repeat the question again? I'm sorry.
Would you characterize your attitude and your demeanor on that call with Mr. Balian as cooperative?
I think I was being cooperative.
Okay. You were recontacted by law enforcement on February 11, 2016. Do you recall being contacted and immediately saying you're busy, but that you would speak the next morning when you said you'd be available? Do you remember that?
I don't remember that.
Clip number D004, page 2, line 9 to page 3, line 5. This is from the 2/11/16 interview.
98A?
Yes, John.
Hi, is this Doug Oliver?
You're sorry?
John Lewin. I'm a Los Angeles County Deputy District Attorney. I spoke to you, gosh, it's probably been close to a year ago, and then you talked to my partner back in April of 2015. When you and I talked, I wanted to meet you in New York, and at the time, you were unavailable, and frankly, didn't seem very interested in speaking to us. So,
I'm in the middle of dinner right now, a dinner party.
Oh, no problem.
Is it possible, could you call me? We're here in California now?
I'm in California, sure.
If you want to call me tomorrow morning, I'm available.
Okay.
Anytime after 8 o'clock New York time.
Do you recall what happened the next day?
That's my recollection. I can't recall that.
Okay. Do you recall the next day being called, Mr. Oliver, at the time that you had agreed, and saying, and during that conversation, it was again not a good time to talk, and picking the date of February 16, 4 days later at 4 p.m. to talk? Do you recall that?
No.
Clip D005, 2/12/16, page 5, line 25, to page 7, line 28.
99A?
Please, Your Honor, thank you. Yeah.
Make an appointment
figure out. Let's figure out a time right now. You tell me what works. I have my calendar out.
And also, I'm not sure how I can help you. That's the whole thing. What I can do for either side of the house.
Well, listen.
I don't see why you would want to waste the time talking to me.
Well, listen, don't worry about my time. If I didn't think you had information, I wouldn't be talking to you. So, I'm good. You don't need to worry about it. I'm more than, I've talked to many, 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 many people, and you're another person on the list. So, you know, you let me know what the time is. I just want to make sure that, you know, and again, I have to ask this.
Sure.
So let me know what day works.
Do you recall if you made yourself available on February 6th?
Motion to strike, Your Honor. Relevancy.
Denied.
Did you make yourself available on February 16th, the date that you requested?
I don't recall.
Isn't it true, Mr. Oliver, that you did not make yourself available, and then you were called the next day on February 17th, 2016? Do you recall that?
That's my recollection. I don't recall any of these conversations.
So as far as you know, you've never spoken to me before?
No, I've spoken to you.
But you don't recall the content of any of the conversations, is that correct?
No, I don't recall the content.
So on the 17th, Mr. Oliver, isn't it true that you were called and instead of explaining why you had not been available at the time you agreed, you merely stated that you had missed the interview because you were on a plane again? Do you recall that?
No, I don't recall that.
Clip D006, 217-16, page 2, line 10, to page 6, line 9.
Relevancy. Engagement on a collateral matter.
Overrule.
Where are we going with this, Judge?
Well, the witness's credibility is being questioned.
Why does this go to credibility that he doesn't want to talk to Lewin? I don't want to talk to him.
Okay, well, I don't start.
I won't be asking, so no. We probably won't have a conflict.
Your credibility's fine, Mr. DeGuerin, so we're not going to even address it. So it's unquestionable. But here we have a witness, and his credibility's an issue. So you may proceed, Mr. Lewin.
And by the way, it's nothing personal.
Nothing. 100 day?
One of your fangs nipped me when you turned around, Mr. DeGuerin.
I don't know how you can see it, but this damn thing.
It's they sneak out the side.
Your Honor, I don't want to interrupt the back and forth, but 100 and 100 day?
Yes.
Mr. Oliver, this is John Lewin, L.A. County District Attorney's Office.
Hi, how are you?
Well, I'm not real good because we had an appointment yesterday at 1.
Yeah, no, I was in an airplane.
Okay, you realize we made that appointment at your, that was the date you chose. You didn't call us.
Whoa. Hey, I was in an airplane. What am I supposed to do?
Okay. Well, listen,
Don't give me a hard time.
Well, then, all right, then listen, let's, we'll...
Okay, sure.
Well, Mr. Oliver,
he... I'm on an airplane. What do you want me to do about that? Well, the story, okay? It was very bad weather down here, and we were delaying.
Well, listen, so then we'll...
This is starting to really annoy me, okay?
Then we'll take it going forward. Listen, what are you talking...
What do you mean take it going forward?
Meaning,
I'm a lawyer, okay?
No, listen, let me tell you what I mean. So what I'm saying...
I'm upset now, it's what you're talking about. Like,
well, here's the situation. What are you talking about?
What is the situation?
Can I, Mr. Oliver? Can you listen to me for a second? You're not letting me answer. You're not letting me answer in anything.
You're not listening to me, okay? You're asking me for help. Don't put me down because I couldn't reach you on the phone, okay? And if you don't want to deal with me that way, then don't deal with me. You don't have to talk to me.
Well, Mr. Oliver, here's the situation. There's a couple of ways.
What's the situation?
That's not. If I can tell you, I'll let you know. Whether you talk to us is up to you outside of the courtroom. We believe you've got information. If you don't want to speak to us, we'll just subpoena you and bring you to court. I would prefer it.
Look, you have your right to do anything.
Okay,
now, you're getting me upset because you're not, it was very nice, you were very good. Maybe you weren't the person I spoke to before. You have a much better manner than you do. But you sit there and immediately attack me because I picked up the phone yesterday. I do not like that, okay? So why don't you go think about it and then call me back when you decide you want to talk to me like a gentleman.
Well, Mr. Oliver, I'm speaking.
Listen.
Let's just
get the facts straight. You're asking for my help, correct?
I'm not asking for your help. I'm asking you just find out information that you have. But listen.
No, you're asking for your help because why would I do this if it's not if you're asking for something?
Well, I would hope you would do it because two people.
Because why?
Because two people have been murdered.
But they've been murdered when they were by home.
Well, so that's why we're trying to find out what information you might have. Listen.
I thought in this country that you were innocent and proven guilty. You're sitting there saying you're assuming that he murdered. I don't know.
I didn't mention Bob Durst at all. I simply said two people have been murdered. But listen, my apologies if I was annoyed that you didn't call us back. And listen, I took you not calling me yesterday as you know what. You just weren't going to speak to us and didn't want to give us a call to let us know. If that's incorrect, then my apologies. And when I said let's take it.
First of all, you don't leave messages, okay?
I did. I left messages on three different phones.
I mean, your stuff comes through. I was on a plane.
Okay. Well, listen. Then.
From the airplane, it's expensive to use these phones. Okay, and very expensive.
Would you agree that during that call, Mr. Oliver, that you made clear that you would not speak over the phone? That you would not allow us to come interview you in New York, and that the only way you would come to California was on your private airplane if we paid for your gas. Is that what you told us?
I don't recall it.
So. Oh, okay. Clip D007, 217-16, page 6, line 10, to page 8, line 6.
It's a 101A.
Eventually, this is going to get... tiring and boring arguing about whether to talk, Judge. It's not relevant to any issue in the case. That's my objection, and it's impeachment on a collateral matter. And he said he doesn't remember. He didn't deny making the statement.
No, but he does. He's saying he doesn't remember, and I find that is inconsistent. So overruled. Objections. Overruled.
May I have the witness on voir dire?
No.
To determine whether he has a way of remembering it.
No, I'll let Mr. Lewin do that. You may proceed, Mr. Lewin.
Thank you, Your Honor.
Hey, listen, so you get subpoenaed and bring me up to California, I'll take them to California.
Okay, so. So is what you're saying.
That sounds like a great deal for me.
Well, listen, Mr. Oliver, we would like to speak to you. In the end, it's your decision whether you talk to us or not outside of a subpoena. I'd like to speak to you.
But when they do a subpoena, do they pay for me to come out there?
Do they? Yes. The trip is paid by us.
I only travel. Good, because I have a plane ready.
No, it doesn't. You know, it doesn't. We don't play for your private plane. You fly on coach.
That's terrible.
Well, listen. When I travel for the office, I don't get to be on a private plane either. Although it sounds like I like your way of flying better than mine.
Hey, well, listen. I'd love to come to LA to talk to you.
Well,
that'd be a fantastic thing.
Well, listen. If we can kind of start over right now.
Mr. Oliver, this is Habib Bailey, and I'm the first gentleman you spoke with a couple months ago. I don't know, do you remember me? Maybe last year.
First gentleman.
I was the one, I called you up and I was asking you some questions, and you ended up not really answering any of my questions. You wanted to ask me a bunch of questions, and I was explaining to you that I couldn't provide you information in an investigation. I don't know, do you remember me?
By the way, I'm the guy, John Lewin. Well, listen. When I talked to you last week, you said you liked me, and I answered all your questions. I didn't get to ask you any of mine. So here's where we are. We're asking to speak with you. If your answer is, you know what, I'm refusing to speak with you, that you need to bring me out here, let me just advise you of what the process is. So what we have to do is we have to subpoena you through New York, which is okay.
Would you agree, Mr. Oliver, that by the end of that February 17, 2016 call, you would not give us an answer of whether you were willing to be interviewed, and you asked to be called again the following Friday, where you would give your answer finally whether or not you would agree to be interviewed? Do you recall that?
Yes, sir, I recall that.
Oh, okay. I won't have to play this one then. Do you recall if you made yourself available the following Friday as you said you would?
I don't remember if I did.
Would it surprise you if you didn't?
And it wouldn't surprise me.
So, you were called again on February...
Would you repeat your answer?
No.
The jurors couldn't hear you. Say it again, loud.
No.
No, it would not surprise you, correct?
No, yes.
You need to speak out loud. You're mumbling.
No, yes. No, correct. Okay.
And I just have to ask, Mr. Oliver, when you make plans with people to be interviewed or for phone calls, do those plans that you make, do those have any relevance to you as to whether or not you're actually going to follow through with them?
But I'm here today.
Yes, you are here today under subpoena by threat of being put on a plane in handcuffs. That is correct.
Strike it and ask the jury disregard that.
Disregard that, ladies and gentlemen.
Mr. Oliver.
I'll have a motion on the brief.
Well, I was never threatened.
Thank you.
On February 29th, when you did not make yourself available as you had indicated, you were called again, is that correct?
I don't recall when you called me again.
Do you recall during that phone call, again, making demand that you needed to be flown out on your private plane?
I don't remember.
Do you recall if you were rude and uncooperative?
I don't think I was rude or uncooperative.
Clip D009-229-16, page 2, line 10 to page 5, line 8.
102-102A.
Thank you, Ron.
What night?
Give it to you again. It's going to be page 2, line 10 to page 5, line 8.
No. What date?
229-16.
Thank you.
Hi, is this Doug Oliver?
Yes.
Mr. Oliver, this is Deputy DA John Lewin.
Yes.
You were going to call me on Friday, but we didn't know.
That isn't the way we left it at all. You said you wanted to call me, and I said, I don't care if you call.
Okay, well, I called you on. I called you on Friday.
Yeah, I was in London, so what do you want?
Well, so what did you decide to do?
I didn't decide to do anything.
You were going to be, if you recall, we put this over because...
First of all, I really am offended that you want to bring me out there. You're not going to bring me out private. I won't go.
On on your private plane?
No, I will not go coach. I won't do it.
Well, okay. Well, the county doesn't play for people to fly first class.
I'm not
going to
go on a commercial.
Right, listen, you want to be uncooperative, it's your option.
I'll be uncooperative.
Listen, what we'll do is, very simple.
Don't threaten me.
Hey, listen, I'm not threatening you at all. I'm telling you how it's...
Screaming,
okay. Mr. Oliver, let me...
Listen,
I'm being as much...
You're raising your voice.
All right, listen. All right, let me keep my voice down. Okay, here I go.
Take a drink and calm down.
I can't really drink, although I'm starting to think about it.
No, go get yourself a glass of water and calm down.
I'm good. So here's the situation. Okay.
What's the situation?
So the situation.
I don't appreciate your calling me when I'm in London.
Mr. Oliver, this is Investigator Savary. Would you please let Mr. Lewin finish a sentence without interrupting?
Why are you?
Because we're not getting anywhere with this conversation.
You know what? You're really annoying me because you're not being very polite.
Well,
okay? And I don't like threats, okay? Well, you lose me 100% when you threaten.
Well, listen, okay, Mr. Oliver. Listen, here's the situation. I can't force you to talk to me. It's completely up to you whether you're going to talk to me or not. If you don't want to talk to me, I'm just telling you that my options that are left, which I will use, is I'm going to subpoena you. You're going to end up having to go into court at least
once.
I'm
going to find you against a person. Okay.
So you're...
I'm going to be in London, okay? Okay, you're coming to London again.
So why did you say at the end of that clip that we would have to find you and you would be in England?
I don't remember why I said that. But I'm here now.
Would you again, Mr. Oliver, would you deem that conversation as you being cooperative?
I don't think I was being uncooperative. I'm just being truthful to you.
I can't hear you. Say it again, louder.
What would you like me to say, sir?
Okay, the last thing you said. Well, let's have our court reporter repeat it, the answer, so the jurors can hear it. I think you can reject it.
I don't think I was being uncooperative. I'm just being truthful.
All right, I think it's time for our recess. So it is 3:05 p.m. We'll come back at 3:20. Do not converse among yourselves or with anyone else on any subject connected with this case. Do not form or express any opinion on the case. Do not discuss your testimony with any other witness. You may step down from the witness stand, but you may not leave the court. Okay, so you should, he says he wants to talk to his lawyer. His lawyer's here. How can he talk to his lawyer?
Oh, his lawyer is, I think, Mr. Ted Romero can bring him to his lawyer.
Okay, will you bring him to his, he wants to talk to his lawyer. You can talk, he'll take you to your lawyer, okay?
Sure, thank you. Appreciate it.
Okay.
I'll wait till he leaves.
Yes. Fifth and the 22nd, that's it. Okay, the witness has left the courtroom. There's a motion or a...
Your Honor, I understand that the court said that this was being done because his credibility is in question. He hasn't answered a factual question, so I'm not clear on how his credibility
was in question. Secondly, all this is a comment on a United States citizen's constitutional right to refuse to speak to the police, which I'm not clear on why that's problematic. Not wanting to speak to the police is a right, and to transpose that into somehow you're not being cooperative, that's a slippery slope, Your Honor.
I don't think so, Mr.
But I move for a mistrial, Your Honor, because I also don't think that Mr. Lewin knows that he said, I think it was live, I couldn't tell if it was the tape or him, about you came out here because we were going to put you in handcuffs.
Well, the fact is, I issued a warrant for the man's arrest.
Okay, but why does the jury get to hear that?
Well.
No, seriously, Your Honor.
I think that's a problem.
Because it goes to his credibility.
I struck that, by the way, because I still think it's more prejudicial than probative, and not to the level of being a mistrial, but that's not necessary that they know that he'd be in handcuffs. But he could very well have been placed in handcuffs. So I don't think he would have been placed in handcuffs. I think when confronted with the warrant, and he did come here voluntarily. But no, that's no grounds for a mistrial. Now, as far as the substance, what you didn't hear, Mr. Chesnoff, but Mr. DeGuerin and I, we had a sidebar off the record where I asked Mr. Lewin whether there was going to be some substance here, because the point isn't to put the man on the witness stand, associate him with Mr. Durst, and then humiliate him. On the other hand, I trust that there is going to be a relevant point. Now, the fact that the impeachment is coming before the relevant point is very interesting to me. I will allow it because I think that Mr. Lewin's going to great length to show the profound lack of credibility of this person. He's the least credible person and the least cooperative person I've ever seen in my career as a lawyer or as a judge. No, that's not true. I saw some gang members who were similar. But that being said, I mean, this is his behavior is terrible. And it's not just a matter of you're right not to speak to the police, because he didn't just refuse to speak. He played with Mr. Lewin and Mr. Bailey in an abusive way. And I think that Mr. Lewin is displaying this for the jury, and the jury will know when the facts come from this person and the way that they come from this person, that is something for them to keep in mind. I think this is a good impeachment. The thing that's unorthodox is that the impeachment is coming after before the fact.
Your Honor, just personal privilege, Your Honor.
Okay.
You have taken the attitude that this is an uncooperative or an incredible, not credible witness solely because he had the guts to stand up to an abusive prosecutor.
That's false. That's false. I'm sorry. I'm observing the evidence as it is presented to me, and I am seeing a profoundly uncooperative person. And so the questions of his credibility are well taken, and I'm not taking sides. I just don't. I think this witness is impeachable. I had to issue a body attachment for this guy. I find that shocking. Really, I had to hold a body attachment. I ordered him to come back. He was insolent, really, toward the court when I ordered him to return. He was very rude and disrespectful, and that pervades his presentation at all times. Am I letting you know that I don't think that he's very credible?
Your Honor,
yes.
May I say this to you? Your opinion is respected by us. What I'm having trouble with it is he's not credible about what?
Right.
In fact there is no relevant testimony to be extracted from this man, then all that happened here was somebody associated with Mr. Durst is presented to the jury, who draws the same conclusion you drew, which is that he's of bad character, and that is definitely prejudicial to Mr. Durst. So I'm waiting to see what it is that the state thinks that Mr. Oliver adds to the proof of the charges.
So that's fair enough. It's a call for an offer of proof. You have the discovery. I do not. So, Mr. Lewin, what do you intend to prove of this witness such that this embarrassment is justified?
So, Your Honor, I'm going to go through. This was Mr. Durst, one of his closest friends at the time Kathy disappeared. He was speaking to Mr. Durst during the week after Kathy disappeared. He has said repeatedly that he never asked Bob Durst what happened with Kathy, and has in essence stated that he really didn't want to know the answer. He has further stated, and he gives us information regarding Mr. Durst's cheapness with respect to his friends. He gives information regarding how close Bob Durst was to Susan Berman, how close he was to Nick Chabon. I can go on and on, but the only thing
you're starting to mention some things that are on the edge of being significant.
But so, Johnny, can I say something, please, Your Honor?
Yes.
That's not. Why would he be impeached then?
So okay.
So we're gonna let it. We're gonna bring him here to establish what they want, and then we're gonna show that he's a bad character and associated with Mr. Durst. That's the exact point, Your Honor.
Tell me what else he's going. Just explain
if I continue, I'll go through my list here.
Yeah.
He's gonna mention that. Then, by the way, we should add, the defense told me in advance he was going to be a defense witness, and I agreed to let them call him while he was out here as their witness. So because of that, and in combination with the idea that rather than asking him a bunch of questions in advance, which he was going to obfuscate, lie, evade, etc., that I wanted to demonstrate first that he was not credible, and that in essence he was hostile.
So wait a second. So I guess I need an offer of proof from Mr. DeGuerin. Mr. DeGuerin, you're calling him as your witness or establishing on your cross-examination some fact important to Mr. Durst?
The agreement was that I would cross-examine whatever Mr. Lewin puts on as his witness, and then I would take him as my own witness, yes.
And what's your offer of proof?
Well, my offer of proof is that he knew Kathy Durst, he knew Bob Durst, he knew Susan Berman, he was in the group that were all friends, and I want to establish what he knew about that group and their activities in the late 70s, early 80s when Kathy disappeared and for a little while after that. He is a percipient witness to the relationships that existed at that time.
All right, so in combination, your evidence in combination with the people's evidence makes him a witness of substance who can be impeached as he has been.
Why don't we could let him take him now and then Mr. Lewin can finish after.
I'm more than happy if Mr. DeGuerin prefers. In fact, Your Honor, I made the offer. This was a favor to Mr. DeGuerin and to counsel. I made the offer actually this week and I said, listen, do you want to do Doug Oliver first? You're more than welcome because I have a lot with him. I did not go through and explain to Mr. DeGuerin how I was going to impeach him, but you would have to be a first-year lawyer, if you've listened to any of the discovery, not to realize where this was heading and the way that he's behaved in court. I'll make the offer right now. If Mr. DeGuerin wants to do his examination now first, I'm more than happy to give up the time to let him start, and I'll finish.
Is
either
that
way.
Your preference? You'd ask to take him on voir dire, so would you like to take the witness as your witness now and then go back to Mr. Lewin?
No, I'm happy for Mr. Lewin to get whatever he thinks he wanted from him, bad enough to have you issue a body attachment for
okay.
him.
Yes.
And then I'll do mine. Mr. Lewin was gracious enough to let me not have to bring him back out here to get what I want. I might be able to get everything that I want out of Mr. Lewin's examination and my cross-examination of Mr. Lewin's examination. And then, if I don't, then I will say, yes, we now accept him as our witness.
All right, thank you. Thank you for explaining. The offer of proof is acceptable, and the impeachment may proceed.